Hi all, welcome to Smart Catalyst. Today we'll be discussing the current affairs from the Hindu, Indian Express, Limeint and PIB. These are the topics we'll be covering for prelims. The first one is about the nuclear energy conclave. Second article is about Arya Mahasammelan event. The third is about the new agri-export policy aiming to double farmers' income. The fourth is Spark scheme. Fifth is Impress scheme. And the sixth is the Tagore Award reputed for cultural harmony. The first article is about the nuclear energy conclave. Why it is in news? Recently, India organized the 10th Nuclear Energy Conclave. What is the theme of this energy conclave? The theme is nuclear power towards a clean and baseload energy. Apart from power generating capacity of nuclear energy, in the conclave, many other ideas were mooted. What were they? Using nuclear technology in agriculture, in medicine, low-cost solution for water purification. We all know that India is facing a stark groundwater shortage. Using nuclear technology in water purification will help in building efficient desalination plants through which India's water needs can be addressed. Using nuclear technology to urban waste management through incineration. And the last aspect would be to using nuclear technology to preserve foods. We all know that radioactive material can be used to preserve perishable food items. India has also proposed to construct its first permanent exhibition on nuclear power in Delhi, which is known as Hall of Nuclear Power. This Hall of Nuclear Power will help the students to understand the basics of nuclear energy. So why is nuclear energy more important to India? India, in order to sustain its GDP growth, has to produce more energy. GDP is always proportional to energy. Coal being more polluting, and the cost of renewable energy being very high, nuclear energy can be used as a potential solution to our energy demand. But in reality, the share of nuclear energy is just 3% of the total installed power, whereas the global average is 10%. As we discussed earlier, 75% of energy is still coming from coal-powered plants. So, in the map, we have provided the important nuclear power producing sites in India. UPSC has the practice of asking questions based on location of important nuclear reactors. Of them, Kaiga has been in use of late. Why Kaiga is in use? Kaiga is producing more power per day in the Asian region. And it has been operating uninterrupted for 895 days. And this Kaiga reactor is a pressurized heavy water reactor, and at present in India we have 16 indigenously built pressurized heavy water reactors. So what are these pressurized heavy water reactors? In India we have three different types of reactors, nuclear reactors. What are they? One is heavy water reactor, the second one is pressurized heavy water reactor, and the third is force breeder reactor. What are the differences between them? Of them, PHWR is more important, and more than 16 reactors in India are based or working based on PHWR principle. So, uranium in the naturally occurring form of 238 is non-fissile. It has to be enriched in order to convert it into uranium-235, which becomes a potential nuclear fuel. This uranium-235 placed in a fuel rods. They are inserted into the nuclear reactor. During the fissile reaction, the neutrons are emitted from the uranium-235. And what happens in a pressurized heavy water reactor? In pressurized heavy water reactor, the speed of this fast-moving neutrons, fissile neutrons, are reduced by the heavy water. Heavy water is nothing but deuterium oxide. Deuterium is an isotope of hydrogen, and deuterium oxide is known as heavy water. This heavy water controls these fast-moving neutrons, reduces their speed, thus bringing the system into an order. The energy thus produced in this process is used to turn the turbine through which electricity is produced. This heavy water reactor is significantly more expensive because heavy water by itself is very rare and it is expensive. Now India is slowly moving to fast breeder reactors and other new technologies to produce nuclear energy through abundantly available thorium in India. The next article is about the inauguration of Arya Mahasammelan by President of India. So what is the purpose of this conference? Sammelan is conference. What is the purpose of this conference? The purpose of the conference is to bring the eternal absolute truth to the forefront in the society and in front of every person, so that the lives of everyone can improve in a noble manner, by which the universe will be made a noble society. Arya Samaj, right from its beginning in 1875, had been working on the fields of preventing superstition, supporting modernization, supporting women empowerment, working on tribal welfare, and most importantly in social activism in management of natural calamities. Now, with the evolving need of the society, Arya Samaj has now proposed to promote the use of solar and other alternative sources of energy, thus improving the quality of environment in India. Normally, whenever there is a history-based news item appearing in PIB, we can expect a question from the background of that information. Now, we saw about Arya Samaj, it is pertinent to know about the organization and the foundation of Arya Samaj. And if you want to know about the foundation of Arya Samaj, we should know about Swami Dayanand Saraswati. Dayanand Saraswati is the founder of Arya Samaj. He founded Arya Samaj in 1875 as a reform organization. Hinduism during late 19th century was marred with cultural backwardness. This cultural backwardness was opposed by social reformers like Dayanand Saraswati, Rajaram Mohan Roy, Ishwar Chandra Vidyasagar, D'Orazio, and other educated Indians. And what was the basic principle followed by Dayanand Saraswati? Dayanand Saraswati believed in the infallibility of Vedic literature. And with that belief, he gave the slogan, "Go back to Vedas." He believed that, he reinstated the fact that in Vedic civilization, women were treated equally. The practices of society was based on science and reason. Based on that belief, he professed modernism in Indian society. He wrote few important books like Satyarth Prakash, Veda Bhasya Bhumika. Apart from this, Arya Samaj, started by Dayanand Saraswati, also involved in many educational activities. All of those Dayanand Anglo-Vedic schools present in many parts of India were started under the auspices of Arya Samaj. Apart from education, they also worked for upliftment of all sections of the society, especially women and the deprived classes. Proposed and introduced another important but controversial aspect called Shuddhi, by which the people who got converted to alien religions of India were once again reconverted to Hinduism. The next article is about the new agri-export policy proposed by the government of India to double the farmers' income. In 2018 prelims, there was a question on organic farming. In that, a statement mentioned that organic farming falls under the Ministry of Rural Development. Normally, our commonsensical approach would push us to think that organic farming would come under the Ministry of Agriculture. But organic farming actually falls under the ambit of Ministry of Commerce and Industry. We should remember those facts which are against our commonsensical notion. I repeat, organic farming falls under the ambit of Commerce and Industry. Fine, why it has come in the news now? Recently, Union Minister of Commerce and BioFac India organization, they both spoke on agro-specific zones. Okay. They both spoke about building agro-specific zones in India. This agro-specific zone would boost the outbound shipments of organic commodities. With increasing wealth all over the world, there has been more demand for organic food items. India, being located in a tropical region, it has diverse agroclimatic regions. Because of this, India has the advantage of producing different varieties of organic produce, which can be used to boost our agri exports. The data suggests that India is already ranking first in the terms of total number of organic producers. This is quantity of farmers. But as far as the quantity of produce is concerned, we are lagging behind. another fact suggests that India is ranking 9th in the terms of world's organic agricultural land, that is total land under organic farming. Of them, India ranks 9th in the world. The work on improving organic farming and realizing the potential of organic farming in India is undertaken by Agricultural and Processed Food Products Export Development Authority, also known as APIDA. Another fact pertinent to this organic farming in India is that Sikkim became the world's first organic state. All the agricultural produce in Sikkim or all agricultural products in Sikkim are produced through organic means. The next article is about the recently inaugurated India Mobile Congress, which has begun in Delhi. Okay, the second edition of India Mobile Congress is inaugurated in Delhi. This is one of the largest mobile, internet and technology event in South and Southeast Asia. So any international event or any congress or conference, it has a theme. And the theme indicates, theme is the agenda for the meeting, and it indicates how the deliberations in the meeting would go on. The theme for this India Mobile Congress is New Digital Horizons, Connect, Create and Innovate. And this connect has impact on smart cities. This create has impact on building entrepreneurs in India. And this innovate can be related with India's underutilized innovation potential. This connect, create and innovate all together can help in achieving the potential growth of India under Industrial Revolution 4.0. This India Mobile Congress will be helpful in attracting investors in India. Apart from this, it will also witness the launch of several innovative products and encourage the emerging startups. This technology disseminated by this India Mobile Congress will help in paving the path for a digitally connected India. In the India Mobile Congress, there were few important announcements made by the government. What were they? The first one is to set up 1 million Wi-Fi hotspots in India by 2019. This is an important step towards digital empowerment. The mobile phone industry is based on frequency. And what are these frequencies? The frequency is nothing but the electromagnetic spectrum allocated to the telecom operators. So the government has proposed for a national frequency allocation plan 2018, which is a pioneering roadmap for Indian digital communication industry. As of now, the government is providing license only for 50 megahertz frequency of spectrum. Now the government is proposed to increase that 50 megahertz to a quantum of 605 megahertz. This has been done to meet the ever-growing appetite for data in India. In order to reap the benefits arising out of Industrial Revolution 4.0 and the benefits arising out of digitalizing the connectivity in India, India has been working on building the 5G network in India. So in this India Mobile Congress, many demonstrations for these 5G devices were arranged, and original equipment manufacturers from different parts of the world were displaying their equipment capacity to integrate 5G technology in India. This would give impetus to small and medium entrepreneurs in India, especially in telecom sector. Also, India has signaled the spectrum plans for 5G services. This means 5G is not far away in India. These initiatives proposed by the government will make India to achieve the position of leader in digital connectivity in the world. The next article is about the SPARK scheme of Ministry of Human Resource and Development. So what does this SPARK stands for? The SPARK is Scheme for Promotion of Academic and Research Collaboration. What the government is aiming to achieve through this SPARK scheme? Through the scheme, the government is aiming to improve the research ecosystem of India's higher educational institution. How it's going to improve the research ecosystem? It is through collaboration between the leading researchers and scientists from different nations. Universities from 28 selected nations have been shortlisted, and from them researchers and scientists would be invited to India, and they would work along with Indian researchers and scientists to provide solution for problems of national and international relevance. Apart from this, it also proposes to enable productive academic cooperation by supporting few critical components which can catalyze impact making research in India. And this park is important move taken by the Ministry of HRD to improve the research potential of Indian universities. The next article is about the scheme IMPRES of Ministry of Human Resource and Development. What does this IMPRES stand for? IMPRES is Impactful Policy Research in Social Sciences. India is lagging in research, and of the already happening scanty researches in India, social sciences, they receive even more less share. So research in social sciences is too crucial in a diverse country like India, and in order to ensure that social sciences is thriving in a research ecosystem, the scheme has been brought up. So what are the proposals under the scheme? Under the scheme, 1500 research products will be awarded for 2 years to support the social science research in higher education institutions of India. And any scheme, it needs an implementing agency. Who is the implementing agency for this IMPRES scheme? Indian Council of Social Science and Research would be the implementing agency. The scheme will focus on few thematic areas like state and democracy, urban transformation, media, culture and society, employment, skills and rural transformation, governance, innovation and public policy. Apart from this, it will also have few thematic researches under the areas of macro trade, economic policy, social media and technology. The next article is about Tagore Award for Cultural Harmony. Rabindranath Tagore stood for a cultural diversity of India, and his stand in cultural diversity of India is well defined through the national anthem he wrote for India. In order to respect the cultural harmony patronized by Rabindranath Tagore, the Government of India in 2012, it instituted an award by his name, which is given for outstanding achievement in fostering harmony and universalism and values of cultural harmony, especially in conflict or extreme situations, through innovative strategies. This award can be awarded to any individual irrespective of the nationality of that individual or nationality of that organization. This is open to all persons regardless of nationality, race, language, caste, creed or sex. Now, UPSC is not going to ask about who got the award and who got the Tagore Award in which year and all. UPSC will ask about the area from which the awardees were selected from. Recently, the Tagore Award for the year 2014 was awarded to Sri Rajkumar Singhajit Singh, who is a doyen of Manipuri dance. Now, it's important for us to know about Manipuri dance. Manipuri dance has various forms of them. Tangta, Natha Sangeertana, Loy Haroba and Rasalila, which are the prominent dance forms under Manipuri dance. Rabindranath Tagore was deeply influenced by the Manipuri dance. The sensuous moves of Manipuri dance was complementing the ethos of Rabindranath Tagore's poetry. Let's see the background information related to the Manipuri dance. Manipuri is one of the Indian art or classical dance, and it has been included under the classical dances under Ministry of Culture. In a mega diverse, culturally mega diverse country like India, only 8 dances have been included under, has been given the classical dances tag. And Manipuri being included under that classical dances tag indicates the cultural importance of Manipuri dance. Like as in many other cultures, the dance in Manipur is also associated with rituals and traditional festivals. There are legendary references to the dances of Shiva, Parvati and other god and goddesses who created the universe in Indian mythology. Manipuri dance has its roots in Vaishnavism. But the Loy Haroba, the main festivals which is still performed in Manipur, has its roots even to the pre-Vaishnavite period. This indicates that it has a continuing existence. The Manipuri dance has got a continuing existence. The dancers who perform the Lai Haroba dance are known as Maibas and Maibis. What do they enact in this Lai Haroba dance form? They reenact the theme of creation of the world. I repeat, in Lai Haroba dance, the dancers reenact the theme of creation of the world. And this Tangta is basically a martial art. And this martial art, with its mellowed down steps, has become a dance form. Rasalila is based on Jayadeva's Gita Govinda, can be attributed to the Vaishnavite influence. It speaks about the relationship between Lord Krishna and Radha. Now let's move to the articles that are important in mains perspective. We will be discussing 5 articles today. The first one is related with end of America's China fantasy. Second one is about the necessity to introduce wholesale banks in India. Third one is about the fecal sludge in Ganga and the need for proactive measures to rejuvenate Ganga. And the fourth one is about disqualification of MLAs in Tamil Nadu. And fifth one is about the climate change and what should we do in order to save the planet. Let's move to the first article. The article is titled End of America's China Fantasy. The article appeared in the newspaper Mint. India and China both became independent in a similar period. That is, India became independent during 1947 and China became independent during 1949. Both their macroeconomic indicators and socio-economic indicators were more or less same. And this led to the popular phrase, Hindi Chini Bye Bye, which was pronounced by Jawaharlal Nehru in Bandung conference. But the growth of China, now China has grown monstrously comparing to India in both macroeconomic and socioeconomic terms. China's growth in macroeconomic terms can be attributed to the constructive engagement of USA, which has led to the rise of China in the present era. The advent of globalization had a positive impact for China's population. With China under an authoritative regime had used stringent measures to improve its manufacturing potential. This manufacturing potential coupling with globalization led to globalization of manufacturing. This led to the economy of scale in China's manufacturing industry, by which China became a leading economic superpower in the world. But with that rise in economic terms, China has also gained some power, gained some position in strategic terms. Because of that ascent of China in under strategic terms, US is now seeking countermeasures to control China from violating the global order. China has been defying the world trade rules and has flexed its military muscles. With this, China is trying to improve its strategic position, and already economically prosperous China, which would naturally pursue economic and political liberalization, would pose a challenge to US position as superpower of the world. This has made US to see China as a potential competitor in strategic arena of the world. But this is the perspective of USA on China presently. Earlier, USA wanted China to grow economically, and USA even recommended China's inclusion in WTO. It was based on the belief that free markets, free election, and free people will democratize China. And it was also believed that entry of China into WTO would create a future for greater openness and freedom for the people of China. This idealistic thought from the presidents of USA has still remained utopian. The recent decade and the past decade has witnessed the rise of Chinese dragon. And this rise of China is mainly attributed by globalization of manufacturing, as we discussed earlier. But
China has reaped the benefits of globalization, but it has not let other countries and other economies to reap the benefits of globalization in a vast market like China, because China is still remaining a restricted economy. And with the advent of digital technology, China is aiming to build an Orwellian state, which is based on surveillance, and the citizens are losing their privacy. And the rise of assertive China in South China Sea region, which is caused by the artificial islands, claim of sovereignty over the islands belonging to other nation through the nine dash line, has created a huge power struggle in the region. Apart from this, China having control over the South China Sea, through which 1/3 of global maritime trade passes, this creates an imbalance in global order. US has started to call China as a revisionist power and strategic competitor. In order to mend the ways with China, US has been imposing tariffs on trade. This US tariffs targeting China would endure for years, and it is being intended to bring about more fundamental and far-reaching change in the trade between the nations. This tariff policy and other rhetorics and other rhetorics posed by USA does not overtly follows anti-China policy. Still, many inhuman activities undertaken by China in its Xinjiang province and against Uyghur Muslims are not questioned by USA. We have added an infographic in this slide. Please refer that for additional information. The author has suggested that curtailing China's ascent cannot be done only through economic levers. It needs a multi-pronged approach. The liberal democratic order of the world was believed to be threatened by communism, but communism could not pose a credible challenge to the liberal democracy. But the prevailing authoritarian capitalism has enough potential to disrupt the liberal democratic order in the world. The author has mentioned that since the rise of Nazism, there hasn't been any other major challenge posed to liberal democratic order in the world. But China's present model, which involves the model followed by China, which is directly taken from the textbooks of neocolonialism, is potent enough to disrupt the liberal democratic order in the world. The author has concluded by saying that China will be likely adopting a two steps forward and one step back strategy to keep progressing towards its ambitious goals. The next article is about the necessity of introducing wholesale banks in India. What is the need to introduce wholesale banking in India? Because the NBFCs, which have been functioning in India, the structural challenges faced by NBFCs in India has created the necessity to introduce wholesale banks in India, says the author. So what are the problems being faced by NBFCs in India? The problems are asset liability, near absence of markets for long tenure commercial papers. These two problems, coupled with the lack of liquidity in corporate bond markets, has increased vulnerability for the functioning of NBFCs in India, which is evident from the recent failures of IL&FS and other NBFCs in different parts of India. This vulnerability has a very potential to create an economic disaster in India. But if a bank is facing crunchy situation like NBFCs are facing now, RBI would act as a lender of last resort. But this facility is not available to NBFC. These are the problems faced by NBFCs in India. So we need holistic, long-term and non-distortionary measures to address the challenges placed in front of NBFCs. So why are NBFCs more important, and what is the role played by NBFCs in India's economic markets? NBFC sector is faring well in these three fronts on comparing with the banks.
the NBFCs are providing credit flow to the sectors whose credit demand has been unmet for a long period, by which they have created a credit inclusion for few sectors, which would have greater impact on economic development in the country. Also, the banks in India are marred with poor asset quality, which has resulted in higher net NPA. But NBFCs have maintained low net NPAs. The capital flows in NBFCs is at present 20%, which is 5% higher than the stipulated 15%. Well, we have seen the problems faced by NBFC and the importance of NBFC and the advantages of NBFCs over the existing banks in India. So, what are the problems in RBI acting as lender of last resort to NBFCs? These non-banking finance companies, they can collect only time deposits or the time liabilities, and based on which they provide loan. They cannot collect demand liabilities. So, if in a financial organization which does not collect demand liability, a lender of last resort disincentivizes the efficient liquidity management of that organization. Keep their reserves under the statutory liquidity ratio, which amounts to 1/5 of their net demand and time liabilities. And it is justiciable for RBI to provide lending at last resort for the banks who maintain SLR. But NBFCs do not maintain any SLR reserves, and RBI providing assistance to NBFCs at last resort would violate the principle of equality. And in order to address the problems faced by NBFCs, the author has recommended the introduction of wholesale banking in India. Wholesale banking was among the differential banks proposed by the Comprehensive Financial Services for Small Businesses and Low Income Households Committee, headed by Nachiket Moore. This committee had recommended to set up differential banks to improve financial inclusion in India. The recommendations include setting up of payments bank, setting up of a small finance bank, and setting up of wholesale bank. Of them, the payments bank and small finance banks have been established already, and the decision on wholesale banks haven't been taken as of now. RBI has shown interest in introducing wholesale banking in India, which is represented by the discussion paper published by RBI in 2017. So, what does a wholesale bank do? They are like a universal bank, but in their they can provide loans. The loans are assets for banks, and in asset side they have freedoms to create variety of assets. That is, they can provide loans to different sectors, and there is no restriction on providing loans, but there is restriction on liabilities, that is collecting deposits. The wholesale banks, they have no access to retail deposits. They can only collect wholesale demand deposits. They cannot collect time deposits. This would improve liquidity in the market. Also, the initial rules framed had stipulated net owned fund requirement of 500 crore to set up a wholesale bank. This can be, the author recommends that the net owned fund can be brought down to 50 to 100 crores. The wholesale banking has two units. One is wholesale consumer bank, and the second is wholesale investment banks. Of them, the wholesale consumer banks undertakes retail loans, and the wholesale investment bank would originate infrastructure and or corporate loans. NBFCs has complemented the credit intermediation of banks by working on many underserved and unserved areas in a profitable manner. The author has proposed a few principles for the wholesale banks. What are they? The one is that a clearer design of wholesale demand liabilities. This demand liabilities alone would create liquidity for the wholesale banks. And apart from the liquidity support from demand liabilities, RBI should pitch in with the lender of last resort measures. Also, the credit offering of the wholesale banks should be based on business strategy. These are the principles recommended by the author. So to conclude with, RBI will get a better grip over potential contagion risks while supporting the banking system on its slow path to recovery by introducing wholesale banking in the banking atmosphere of India. The next article is about the menace of human feces in Ganga River and what the steps should be taken in order to rejuvenate Ganga. Center for Science and Environment, an NGO working on environment-based research, had recently undertaken a survey in Uttar Pradesh. With the increasing number of toilets built in India under the ambitious Swachh Bharat Abhiyan, there has been a construction of more online sanitation systems like septic tanks or pit latrines. And this created a lack of scientific management of sewerages. This lack of scientific management has led to dumping of human excreta, that is almost 87% of human excreta from these toilets with on-site sanitation systems is dumped in water bodies or agricultural lands. This has got greater impact on environment and health of Uttar Pradesh. So what are these possible steps can be taken in order to curtail this problem of dumping excreta in water bodies? So the author has mentioned that the government should initiate immediate investments in decentralized sludge management system. And this decentralized sludge management system has two benefits. First one is it has the potential to improve the quality of environment, and also it can reduce the disease burden imposed by insanitary conditions. Apart from providing decentralized sludge management system, the government should also involve in creating a interdepartmental task force which would identify land to build small treatment systems. Now the business of tanker trucks which empties the fecal material is based on social stigma, and it is run in an unprofessional manner. So the author suggests that the business should be handled in a professional manner, and the social stigma associated with these business should be averted with. Sustainable development goal number 6 has mentioned about is talking about methods of sustainable management of water and sanitation. This problem posing a roadblock in achieving the targets set up under SDG 6. So the government should bring in reform in all aspects of business of sanitation. Bringing in egalitarian policies in large state like Uttar Pradesh provides opportunity to demonstrate government's commitment to policy. The success achieved in Uttar Pradesh can act as an role model for other states, and it has huge potential to transform lives all over India. The next article is about the disqualification of MLAs in Tamil Nadu. Madras High Court had upheld the disqualification of 18 legislatures under the grounds of defection. So defection in India is managed by the anti-defection law, introduced anti-defection procedures introduced under 52nd Amendment Act of 1985. This anti-defection is also defined under Articles 102 and 191 of Indian Constitution. Article 102 speaks of it's related with Parliament, and Article 191 is related with state legislatures. So what are the provisions of anti-defection law placed in 10th schedule? It speaks about disqualification, power to disqualify, and what are the exceptional cases. Okay, what are the criterion to disqualify a member? The first one is related with a member belonging to a particular political party. When does a member lose his membership in the legislature? When he voluntarily gives up the membership of the party, or he violates the instruction given by the party while voting in the assembly. And if his action is being condoned by the party within 15 days of any such action, he would not be disqualified. Or if he has sought prior permission from the party in order to act so, then also he will not be disqualified. The second aspect is related with independent candidate. Independent candidate are not associated or not affiliated with any party during election. And if the independent candidate joins a political party after the election, then he is deemed to be disqualified. The constitution has provided nominated members for state legislatures and Rajya Sabha and also to Lok Sabha. In the lower house of state legislature and lower house of parliament, Anglo-Indian members can be nominated. And if the nominated members join any political party 6 months after becoming the member of legislature, then they are bound to be disqualified. Who has the power to disqualify the members? As far as state legislature or parliament is concerned, the power lies with Speaker of the House or the Chairman of the Upper House. There are few exceptions under this anti-defection law. If 2/3 members of a party, they agree to merge their faction with another political party, then those members who acted against their affiliated parties will not be disqualified. This is an exception under the 10th schedule. The next article is about the actions that should be taken by India in order to answer the challenges posed by climate change. The article is taken from the Hindu. The intensity of climate change faced by our planet Earth in the present Anthropocene era can be understood by the predictions made under Paris Agreement 2015, IPCC special report which was recently released, and a study undertaken in a journal, Nature Climate Change. These predictions necessitate proactive actions from the governments of the world. But however, the intended nationally determined responsibilities proposed by the nations in COP21 in Paris Climate Conference is lagging behind the negative impacts of climate change. Also, the burden has been added up by US pulling out of the climate treaty. Now, this scenario has created a need for a sustainable solution which would not jeopardize the economic development of a country and environmental quality of the country. India faces unique challenges as far as climate change are concerned with. The India faces a socio-economic challenge through climate change. India has been bringing out a vast amount of its impoverished population out of their poverty, and they are being provided with decent living standards through economic development. Also, we have a challenge to cut down our carbon footprint and building resilience to climate change in India. Normally, this would lead to cutting down of industrial development, which would have greater impact on India's economic development. India's ranking in socio-economic indicators like Human Development Index, Multidimensional Poverty Index indicates the abysmal position of India comparing with its peer economies and neighboring countries. So, economic development, economic growth, industrialization is imperative to pull the people out of their poverty. But catering only to the challenges posed by climate change, by cutting down carbon emission and cutting down industrialization, will have impact on create joblessness and poverty in India. On the other hand, if we are not building a climate change resilient systems, there is a increasing chances of natural disasters like floods, landslides, droughts and infectious disease. These both factors acting in tandem as a crucial role in increasing inequality in India. The government of India has introduced many proactive measures and changes to attain balance between environmental protection and economic growth. Government, through its Bureau of Energy Efficiency, has used the phenomenon of social persuasion to encourage people to buy efficient devices, and also in building and cement industry, natural fiber composites, and many far-reaching changes has been introduced to cut down the carbon footprint. Also, the government has got an ambitious target of building up 100 gigawatt solar capacity by 2022. Decentralization is one of the important steps taken by the government. In few states like Jharkhand, they have moved to renewable based microgrids, which would cut down AT&C losses in transmission. India, being a predominantly agricultural country, needs to introduce novel and intelligent measures to protect the environment. One of them would be to introduce zero budget natural farming. Andhra Pradesh has taken a right step by introducing zero budget natural farming. What is zero budget natural farming? Zero budget natural farming is a method of organic farming in which the input cost is almost zero. They use the elements of nature in order to grow the crop with high productivity. This kind of agroecology methods would result in increased crop yield, raising the profits of the farmers. They will trap soil carbon efficiently and reduces dependence on harmful fertilizers and pesticides. These measures has to be undertaken by the government. The authors have commended the measures undertaken by the government to tackle the menace of climate change in India. Also, they have advocated to strike balance between environmental protection and economic development in India. Thank you.